So yeah, today I'm gonna talk about deploying a Django application in CentOS. So many of us do build Django applications or many other kind of applications in our local system, but the problem comes when we are starting to deploy it in a server. And CentOS is one of the like mostly used servers that we use. So that's what I'm gonna talk about. So hi, my name is Saptak Sengupta. I'm an open source contributor. I've been contributing to many projects such as jQuery, then SecureDrop, and I have been contributing to FOSS Asia for last 3 years as well. Professionally, I'm a web developer in Zomato. I also mentor and coach in RGSOC and Google Coding, and this year I will be mentoring in GSOC as well. So let's get started. Yeah. So the usual stuff. Yeah. So when you have a CentOS box from the scratch, I'm expecting that you won't be having anything. So you need to install this kind of thing so that, like, you can use Pip, then you can use PostgreSQL, and then you have all the devil packages that are required by Python. Otherwise, most probably Pip install will fail in most cases if you don't have Python devil. And then we need Nginx, GCC obviously, because Python is based on C. So yeah, so these are the things that you need to install at the very beginning, and basically just copy paste and done. Then we get started with setting up the database. So I will be talking here about PostgreSQL database setup because that's one of the databases commonly used with Django, I feel. I preferably use PostgreSQL most of the time. So in most of the documentations that you will find, the PostgreSQL setting is just these two steps. It will say that setup initdb and then systemctl start PostgreSQL. So it doesn't look really like a big nightmare, but after that, when you try to log into PSQL, yeah, it will fail. The reason being, there is something called pg_hba.com, and that usually is set to peer for all the authentications, like peer and then ID, ENT for the local host. Because of which, when you try to log into this PSQL database from the local host, it will definitely fail. So if you are using an Ubuntu, the link for pg_hba.com will be different, but since we are talking about CentOS, this is most probably the link if you don't change the place where you are installing. So if you use, I have used Vim here or Vi, but you can use Nano or anything that you prefer, any editor. And then you go to the end of the file where you will see something like this. So this basically says that, okay, if it's a local connection, which is basically unique socket connection, you can just use peer method. And if it's a connection over either localhost or this, then you use MD5. MD5 basically means you can use an username or a password to log into the PSQL database. So this is what we set. Then we restart PostgreSQL and then enable. So enable basically ensures that whenever you boot the box again, it gets automatically restarted. Okay, and after that, if you have done this, your PostgreSQL should work fine, but then you have to create a new user because you don't want to be like writing in your settings file the Postgres user itself, right? Because that's not a good practice, at least I think. So to do that, firstly we have to do sudo su minus Postgres. That basically takes you to the Postgres user panel. From there you can just do PSQL and it will log in. That basically uses this first rule, local all peer. So it will peer logging into the system, and then you can first create a database. I have just named it CentOS DB in our case. Then you use create user something with password. Obviously don't use this, I guess. And then grant all privileges on database basically ensures that this user has create database, create table, and all those kind of permissions on this database. So that basically ensures that you have a database, a user, and a password that you can set up to create the Django application. Slash Q, yeah, it's basically everything inside this is SQL, but slash Q is a PSQL command. In so yeah, slash Q, you can even use Control D if you're used to that. That will, in fact, you do double Control D, so it will do both slash Q and exit for you. So whatever you prefer. So that ensures that you are back into the terminal where you were working. So now we get started with Django. So as most Python users already know, we like to get started with a virtual environment created. It's not preferred that you install everything in one place and then you don't know what is the installation for this particular project, what is the installation for that particular project, dependency layers, this, that. So better create a virtual environment, right? So sudo pip install virtual and basically installs the package. You do virtual and dojo and or whatever the virtual and name you want to give, and that basically creates a virtual environment for it, and this basically activates the virtual environment. So how can you understand you have activated the virtual environment is the yay bracket thing. So a bracket thing like this will happen. So when you see this, you know that whatever the packages are there, it's actually the virtual environment packages you are showing and not the packages that are installed in your own system. So when we have set up virtual environment, so it's time to deploy the Django application. So this is something I just created for this demo kind of thing. So this is Django application, like a Hello World Django application. You can clone your own Django application, then do CD. And I hope whoever creates a Django application creates a requirements.txt, otherwise you are gonna have a tough time installing all the Python packages by yourself, but that's your preference. So I obviously created a requirements.txt. If you have that, then pip install minus r requirements.txt installs everything to the virtual environment that you were in. Having done that, in my project at least, I have a settings.py-example which you want to copy. Obviously, I would recommend that you don't push your own settings.py file, because I don't know why you would want everyone to know your database username and passwords. Your choice. So you copy that. If you are doing this way, so you copy this example file into the settings.py, and preferably in your project you put into git ignore if you are using git the settings.py, so that it doesn't get into your commits or status or diff for that purpose. Now you have to open your settings.py, since in settings.py example there are some random username passwords given. So you can like open the file, and then this will be, there will be something like this. So you can basically search for databases and you will get to this line, and then you just change this. So I have this kind of random username passwords, but basically you need to give, this is the database name, this will be the database user that you are wanting to log in with, this is the password, this is host, and this is port. So basically port you can keep empty, or if you are running, like if you haven't changed the port on which Postgres is running, it's keeping it empty will like redirect it to 5432. If you want to change it, then it's a different case. Yeah, basically that's it, and then the database will be saved. Also in my settings.py file, yeah, if I go to this, half of it is cut off. So there is something called allowed host. So in my case, I have kept it as star for this purpose, because it's development and debug is also true. So these are not the things you should be doing in allowed host. You should keep only whatever the host which is supposed to access that file. Yeah. So that's one of the things in settings.py, and if you want to collect your static files as well at some position, you can set the static view. So that's basically the user preferences that is there in the settings.py, which is supposed to be different for everyone. And then time to run Django. So if you have some migrations in your project, then make migrations will create the migrations that were there in the model, but the migration files didn't exist maybe. So make migrations, create all the migrations files. Then you do migrate, that will migrate the, like from the migration files, it will make the changes into the database. And then create super user will create a super user for you, with which you can log in into the admin section of the Django app. And basically run server 0.0.0 more than 8000. So I have used 8000 as a port. You can use anything which is already not used in your system. and 0.0.0 like ensures that you can access it over your IP. And if you do that, after that, if you open the IP address :8000, you will basically get this. Not very interesting, I know, but yeah. So it runs, it works, yeah. But then you don't want to leave your application right here. You, before you are ready to like go to the production, you should check this. So when you do this, do your you will get a bunch of warnings. So these warnings are, I would suggest that you deal with all these warnings, because these actually might create problems for you. So there are some warnings like don't use XSS filters and stuff like that. So it's up to you which all warnings you want to solve with, but Django gives you all the warnings which it thinks might cause problem for your production. So yeah, it is a good thing to do and resolve this. Then give calls. So yeah, we don't want the Django manager py to be handling everything, because with Unicorn you can specify the number of workers that you have and number of services that you want for handling. So it does the load balancing and stuff for you as well. So we will be using Unicorn. So this is basically the command with, you can add other flags as well like workers, so that you can specify like, say I want only 4 workers for running this application. And bind basically binds the application, the WSGI application, to this look IP and port. And then comes Nginx. So Nginx is basically acting as our kind of reverse proxy, and it also helps in load balancing, and as well as we are going to use Nginx for let's encrypt with SSL. So basically it specifies in the very first line that listen to 80, when you have SSL then you will change it to 443. Server name, here you will mention the IP address, or the, if you have a domain already, then you will mention domain. This line basically says that if you can't find a favicon, which is like the tiny icon that appears on the top of the tab when you open a website, then you can kind of ignore it. Then comes this file. So basically we have static, slash static, from where we serve all the CSS, JavaScript, image files in a Django application. So you would want to mention the path where you can find the slash static folders. So this my project will be actually the project name of your folder. This basically ensures that for all the other requests that comes, it gets to the Django application, basically gets the information about the host who is trying to access the web server. So this part ensures that, and then it proxy passes to the localhost slash. And after you have made these changes, so this won't be there, there will be a bunch of other things, so you need to add this to the Nginx conf. And after you have made these changes, you start Nginx, or if it was already running, you can restart Nginx, and then do sudo systemctl enable Nginx, which will ensure that it's again running after reboot. And now if you go to your IP or your domain, then the website should be working. I say should be working because SA Linux might give you a little trouble, for which you can like look up a weed presentation which was given yesterday on SA Linux Info Association. So yeah, then IP tables, nightmares. Yeah, so most of the times it happens that yeah, you leave ports open, which is not a very good thing to do again, because I don't want like all the ports to be open and people attacking me from every site and causing havoc in my server. So the very first thing that you do with IP tables is flush all the IP table ports. Like it will flush everything that was open firstly. This thing, like there can be a bunch of rules. You can read about the IP tables in the link I have provided. I will share the slides after my talk. So here are the few things that I feel should necessarily be done. So this basically blocks any null packets, so that anyone attacks your server with some null packets, then it will just drop that connection. So that is what this line does. And then you allow people to access your web server over 80 and 443. So if you have a mail server, you will also need to put the SMTP ports and stuff like that to access. So that basically deals with the IP tables as well. And then, yeah, SSL is necessary. We don't want our website to be on HTTP. We want it HTTPS. Like, that's the least security we can provide to the website. And Let's Encrypt really makes it very easy to apply SSL certificate to your website. So basically all you need to do is yum install Certbot Nginx. So Certbot Nginx is a package which helps you to create a certificate based on Nginx plugin. So when you run sudo certbot nginx -d example.com and this one, so basically it ensures that the while creating the certificate, the kind of certificate that is created using the Nginx plugin, and that certificate is applicable when you access example.com or www.example.com. So basically any web page that exists in these two domains. And after you do this, there will be a bunch of choices given to you. So you select your choices, hit enter, and if everything goes fine, you will see an output like this: congratulations, yay, your certificate and chain have been saved, blah blah blah, .pem, blah blah blah. And then, yeah, that's basically it. Now if you create, like if you open your website in HTTPS, pull in your domain name, yeah, it works. So that's it from my side. Thanks. Any questions? Okay.